it can be quite overwhelming to think about the possibilities and the companies that we can consider investing into and buying stocks. Now, the goal of this video is to show you my five-step process of how I go from discovering a company through analyzing it and then finally making the decision that I should invest into that company. Now, keep in mind, everyone has a different process for how they go about buying stocks and investing into companies. And so this is something that I do for myself and it works for me, but it might not work for you. And I wanna make that very clear. So let's get started with this video. If you're new here to the channel and you wanna see more videos like this, make sure you subscribe, drop a like on the video, and let's get started here. Now, the first step, while it might seem rather rudimentary, is very important in this process. And it's to fully establish your goals for this money that you are considering investing. And see, for everyone, this is going to be somewhat different. I know for myself, if I'm looking at my total assets and I think, you know, I would like to take some extra cash from my cash accounts and put it into stocks or find some other way to grow it at a faster rate. Well, with every lump sum of money that I consider investing into the markets or into any type of investments, it's essential to think about the longevity and think about the length of which you are looking to invest that money, as well as the expected return that you may get for that. It's important to be realistic with this. Many people who begin investing are assuming that they might be able to double their money overnight. It's possible, but in more likely cases, it's probably going to be some slower but longer term, more steady growth that we might see. Now, the entire goal of investing from our strategy that we discuss on this channel is to focus on minimizing risk, to mitigate risk, and try to lower your risk as much as possible while increasing your potential reward as much as possible. I think one of the mistakes that people make when they start investing is they try to go for a high risk, high reward. We don't want high risk, high reward. We want high reward, low risk. And so creating that gap there is really our focus here. And there's a couple of different financial metrics that we can use to hopefully try to find some stocks that may be undervalued. All right. So I'm going to bring something up that a lot of people will brush over. And, you know, this is somewhat controversial. Not everybody agrees with it. But if you are investing into individual companies, individual stocks, you're essentially saying something, and you're saying that you believe that most other investors are wrong and that this stock should be higher than what it is trading at the moment. If you believe that the markets are efficient, then you might see where I'm coming from on this point. But if you are looking at a stock that is $50 per share and you're thinking about buying it and you buy it, that means that you are essentially thinking that you are smarter than everybody else, because if everybody else knew that it was supposed to be higher, then it would be higher. So markets are efficient, or at least in my opinion, mostly efficient. There are some variables that can affect some stocks that maybe they're not totally efficient, but that is something that it's really important to remember. So I actually suggest picking up a book called A Random Walk Down Wall Street, which kind of really tries to push people into index funds and mutual funds and tell people that, hey, look, even monkeys throwing darts at a dartboard could do just as well as some financial advisors, which is just a really interesting point. And to be honest with you, although I do have a number of individual stocks, I would say that roughly about 18% of my total assets are comprised of individual stocks, while the majority of it, whether it's in cash or in my own investments or in something like index funds, mutual funds, and ETFs. But I do find that it is still important for my investments to focus on some individual stocks, companies of which that I believe have a very high potential for growth in the future. Now, the second step that we can take here after we set our goals and we look at our total assets, we make the decision that yes, I'm looking to invest this into an individual stock or an individual company, then we can go through what we call the discovery phase. Now, the discovery phase can be quite tedious, but it's something that really is an important step in this process. Now, everybody has a different route that they take with the discovery phase, but this is your goal of finding new companies to potentially analyze. You're simply just screening through companies, looking for companies or industries that you believe may be undervalued. And there's a couple of ways you can do this. My best suggestion for people is to start with either an industry that you are very familiar with, whether this is a hobby of yours, whether you work in that industry, or start with a company that you work with or that you know somebody who works in that organization. Because when we're investing, especially into individual stocks, our goal here is to find some type of upper edge. What is it that we know about a company that we can use to essentially be better or smarter than other people who are considering investing into this company. For example, let's say that you work at Red Robin and you really love Red Robin. You notice that the managers are very nice. You notice that there's a line out the door every night. You notice that the company seems to be doing quite well. The company culture is doing quite well. It looks like you're pulling in a lot of revenue. Maybe you're a line cook at Red Robin. And so this is one of the first steps of discovering a company. And so if you work at a company that you think has a lot of great potential, then I suggest the first company that you analyze to decide whether or not you should buy or not buy this stock is to look at the company at which you work. Now, be careful. You don't want to do insider trading. I think most people watching this video wouldn't be prone to insider trading unless, of course, your relative is like the person making the books for some of these companies, or they happen to be on the board or an executive for the company. You probably don't have to worry about insider trading if you're a cook or if you are on the lower level of workforce for the company. But our next thing that we can do here is we can actually pull up a stock screener. I love stock screeners. I think they're super helpful for taking those hundreds of thousands of companies that we could potentially invest into and whittling it down to meet some of our criteria so that we don't have to browse through so many companies, hundreds or thousands of companies, looking for the perfect balance sheet, looking for the perfect cash flow statements and income statements. So what we can do, there's free stock screeners like on Yahoo Finance. I've used that one for years. I noticed that Webull has one as well. So I'll just pull this up here and I'll show you guys. So for example, with Webull, if you go onto the app here and you go over to markets, then if we go up to the top part on Webull, we'll be able to click on Explore. And if you scroll down from the Explore page, you're going to see what's known as a stock screener. And this is going to be super helpful. A lot of different brokerage firms have this. Not all of them have it. Some of the lower end investing apps don't have them, but Webull does. And so if we go and we click Create New Screener, now we can start to filter out some of these companies that we don't want to invest into or that we are wanting to invest into. So for example, right now for region, it's set to the entire United States, which is going to be 5,108 stocks. That's a lot of stocks. So let's start to whittle this down a bit. Let's actually, you know what, let's go to sector and let's say that we're just interested in investing into the transportation sector. Click Done. And now we have 107 stocks that do fit this criteria of the transportation sector. And then we can start to go through and we can start to filter out companies that maybe we are not interested in. For example, if we learn about some of these different financial metrics like the PE ratio, earnings per share, dividends, the trailing PE, net margin, return on equity, return on assets, debt to assets, I suggest reading about all of those. It's going to be difficult to show you each one of those. We'll try to explain them a little bit more in this video, but there's some things that just can't really be taught in a video. It's going to be needed a book or just to start Google searching some of these things like earnings per share and how that affects a company. But start screening through these. And let's say that, for example, we want a PE ratio of, let's say we don't want anything above 30 and we don't want anything in the negatives. Let's say we want something roughly between 5 and 30, which is a pretty broad range for PE ratio. Click Done. And now instead of 107 stocks, we have 50 stocks that fit this criteria. And let's say that we're also looking for a company that maybe perhaps provides some type of dividend as well. So our dividend yield, we can filter this between, let's say we're looking for anything between 2% and 7% or 8%. We click Done. And now instead of 50 stocks, we have 15 stocks that fit this criteria. We can go through and add more filters, but be aware that as you add more filters, it's going to whittle it down to even more. And then suddenly you have no stocks that fit the criteria that you're looking for. So we can view results here. And then this gives us our first initial look at some different companies that fit that criteria that we just screened for. So I think what we'll actually do is we will pick a company here and then we'll kind of go through the process and show you the process that I take to think about investing into a stock. So looking at these 15 different stocks that came up with this Webull stock screener, well, we can go and we can say, you know what? Let's look at UPS. UPS has been pretty popular. We've seen it in the news quite a bit lately. And so we can look at UPS. Now, UPS did fit that criteria that we set for the stock screener. It was pretty broad, pretty basic, just transportation. We set something for the PE, and we set something that paid somewhat of a dividend. Now, our step here, once we have a stock that we think, hey, you know, maybe this has some potential, I want to learn more about it, and I want to see if UPS has some potential. Now, this is where we enter into what we call phase three. And phase three is going to be analyzing every step of the way down what I'm going to call the pyramid. And this is not, you're not going to see this in financial textbooks. I don't know where this came from, but this is my strategy that I use. So we start at the very top. When we start to think about analyzing a company like UPS, I start at the very top. And you start with the total global economy. You analyze the economy. How is the projected global outlook looking for the next year, for the next couple of years? Then we start to whittle it down even further down in the pyramid. And we look at the next step, which is going to be the national or the state or the local economy that that business primarily operates in. Now for UPS, they mostly operate in the United States. So you'd probably look at the US economy as a whole to look at future outlook and look at potential issues that might occur in the total economy as a whole. And then we can start to wean it down even further. Now, for some companies, it's going to be easier to look at the local economies, especially if they have their primary businesses in specific areas. For example, if you are investing into Six Flags, you could look at their primary flagship locations in New Jersey or in some other states, and you can look at those economies and look at those markets. But what we can do is we can whittle it down a bit further now. And after we look at the global economy and the national and the local economy, we have a good understanding of that. Then we start to look at the industry in which a company like UPS may be in. So we're looking at the transportation industry as a whole. What is the average price to earnings ratio in the transportation industry? What is the average earnings per share? And what is the average dividend payout for companies in the transportation industry? These are all very important things that we need to understand. See, in some cases, we see people who think that they are looking at a company that is incredibly undervalued, only to learn that the industry average is also at that level. We've seen this happen time and time again. Now, once we have a proper understanding for the industry, which would be the transportation industry for UPS, we can then move on to the next step, which is looking at some of their core competitors. So we take UPS and we start to look at some of their core competitors, and we group about 3 to 5 different companies that are almost direct rivals to a company like UPS. So in this case, it might be something like FedEx, or it might be something like USPS, which is the US Postal Service, but it's still something that operates very, very closely with something like UPS or FedEx. And we can look at a couple of other shipping services as well. So we start to analyze multiple companies and we start to look at these competitors to then at this point, you might realize that, hey, you know, looking at these financials, UPS might not be the best option. There might be a better option like FedEx, or maybe Amazon might be better. And then we finally get down to the bottom, which is going to be UPS. Or maybe we decided at the upper level that, hey, instead of UPS, we want to look further into FedEx, or we want to look further into Amazon or some other companies that are core competitors to UPS. Now, I suggest looking at all of these because it's important to understand each one of these competitors. But then we can get into what we call phase 4 of this process, which is looking at both qualitative and quantitative analysis to better understand whether this is a company that we want to invest into. Now, on the qualitative side of this, we've probably already done a bit of this. And the qualitative side of investing is to look at a company's culture, to look at the company's board of directors, to look at their CEO, and to understand how this business operates. Then we look at the quantitative side of it, which is going to be looking at some of the primary statements, the financial statements that are really going to be how we are going to analyze this company. Now, we have something like the balance sheet, we have the statement of cash flows, we have the income statement, and then we have the statement of shareholders equity. All of these are very important, and all of these are things that we can find online for free. My biggest suggestion for people is to go onto a company's investor relations page on their website. If you get to this point where you whittled it all the way down to one company that you have a pretty good feeling about, that you like this company, they fit into your stock screener, they're looking better than some of their competitors in the industry, you get to this point, I suggest going onto what we call their investor relations page, at which point you can look at their Form 10K, you can look at their quarterly reports, and to really get a better understanding of their financials. So I just pulled up the investor relations page for UPS because I want to use this as an example to show you how I would go through this process. So you simply just Google the company and then investor relations, and it probably should be the first link. Hopefully you don't get malware or something. So we can look at UPS here, and it's going to have most of the information that we need in order to fully analyze this company. So if we scroll down, we're instantly going to see a couple of things, one of them being reports and information. So we can look at their first quarter earnings, which is probably going to be very important, but I actually like to look at their annual earnings first. So let's go up to financials. Let's click on this, and then we can look at their SEC filings. Now, every public company, unless they're traded over the counter, is going to need to file with the SEC. They have some pretty strict guidelines on the different types of reports that they need to file. And then we found their Form 10-K right here that was issued on February 20th, 2020. Now, I'm going to be honest with you, for this year, because we have this big recession and we have a ton of economic events, a lot of these annual reports and the outlooks for 2020, they're not going to be very relevant because, well, come on, let's be honest. There's been a lot going on in the world, and a lot of companies have seen either massive decreases in revenue and profits, or some companies have seen some pretty large increases in the total amount of revenue and profits from those organizations. So we can read over their Form 10-K. Most of these, you can just download the PDF, which is what I just did here. And we can start to read through all of this. Now, this one is 170 pages. This is like a book. And most of them are well over 100 pages. So this is my best suggestion to people. Read this Form 10-K. Although it might not all be totally relevant, you're going to get a really great understanding for this company, how it operates, to fully be able to vet this company before you consider investing into it. Now, also look at their 10-Qs, which are their quarterly reports, which I would suggest doing, which is more important at this moment for looking at their first quarter earnings and then their projections for quarter two, because it's going to be more likely, it's going to be a lot more accurate now that they had this update with the whole viral situation. All right, so we're currently still on the UPS looking at their Form 10-K, which is about 170 pages. It's practically a book. But there are three primary financial statements that we're really going to need to spend a lot of time analyzing. This is an area where a lot of people start to fall apart. They start to forget about these. They look at the qualitative data. They look at the CEO, they look at the company, and they look at the news, and they say, hey, I'm just going to buy this stock. It looks good to me. Don't do that. This is the part that a lot of people miss out on, is fully understanding and comprehending every aspect of the balance sheet, of the income statement, and of the statement of cash flows. These are all very important. I'm going to pull some of these up, and we'll kind of go through this a little bit, do a little quick and dirty analysis here. But this is the part where most people fail to do their homework on this. So I know this is not going to be simple, but if you're willing to take some time for it, I think you're going to find that this is the most important aspect here. Especially, you know, it reminds me of when you go to the doctors and maybe you feel okay, but then they start to actually get the hard data. They take your blood and they realize that your white blood cell count is low, or they take your blood and they realize, hey, you're low in iron, you have this percentage of this certain mineral in your blood, your cholesterol is at this level, your heart rate is too high, your resting heart rate is far too high. So the actual data is what actually matters in health. Certainly how you feel, that's important, but you need to actually look at the data. And so this is where we get into here with the quantitative analysis, looking at these companies. And so looking at UPS here, and for these different financial statements, you can just Google them. Just go on Google, type in the company that you're thinking about, type in balance sheet, type in financial statements, type in cash flow or income statement, and you're going to find them. But this is on the Form 10-K here. So looking at the total balance sheet here. This is a consolidated balance sheet for UPS. We're going to see assets, and then we're going to see liabilities and shareholders' equity. Now, assets is going to balance out with liabilities and shareholders' equity. You can learn more about that later if you really want to, but I suggest looking over each and every one of these different lines to fully understand how a number like this is calculated, what this number means, and looking at the growth rate or the decline and what this could mean for the company as well. This is absolutely incredibly essential to understand. So looking at this, we can see that UPS in 2019 grew about $7 billion. It went from about $50 billion to about $57.8 billion in total assets. Now, this looks pretty good. It's always better to see a company with more assets than they have liabilities, but this is not going to tell the full picture for us. So scroll through, read about each one of these, learn about them. You can see that total assets, it looks like it's only $57,000 for the end of 2019, but it's actually 57,000 times a million, because up here we'll probably see it says all of these numbers are in millions, just so that they don't have tons of zeros at the end. It would just be just a total waste of ink to have to do that. So we can see that their total assets grew from about $50 billion to about $57 billion in 2019, to the end of 2019. That's probably a pretty good sign, but that's not going to paint the full picture for us. We need to fully understand how each one of these affects the company overall, because some of these you'll see going down. Maybe their total accounts receivable went down from about $940 million to about $382 million for accounts receivable. We can look at all their different assets and see how those were affected, which ones have gone down, which ones have gone up. Very, very important to do that. Now, I am willing to make a video on this, but I'm concerned that people aren't going to watch it. I've been thinking about making a video going in depth about each one of these, although it'd probably be like 5 hours long, but to fully do a full analysis on a company. If you want to see that, comment down below, let me know. I'm only going to make the video if a lot of people want to see it, because I feel if I put out a video about how to read a balance sheet, that just it's going to get like 50 views, because people don't want to see that. I found, and this is sad, but I found that over time in the past 3 years on this channel, it's really depressing to think about this, but people don't want to know how to analyze a company. They want to know what's the best stock to buy. They're looking for the hot stock tip. Now, I know that's not you, because you're watching this video on how to analyze a stock. So congrats to you. I'm thankful that you've made it this far in this video. I'm really appreciative of it. But let's look at the other different financial statements as well. Something like the income statement, also very important. Looking at revenue. Has revenue been growing or declining? Why has it been doing this? You can learn about each one of these in this. Now, we can look for here, for UPS, they're showing just the past 3 years. There's going to be other resources that you can look even further in depth, looking at UPS's total revenue from 2019, 2018, 2017, 2016, 15, 14. You can go all the way back, as far back as you want to go. The data's out there. Might be a little bit difficult to find it in some cases, but the data is out there. I can assure you of that. So looking at total revenue, seeing the growth in it or the decline in it, use some basic numbers, some basic ratios and formulas to calculate certain things like the total change, right? So just some simple numbers here. We can look at this. $71 billion is what they had for total revenue in 2018. And then in 2019, $74 billion. Now this is a difference of about $2.2 billion difference here. If we want to calculate the growth rate in revenue here for this company, we can just use that simple formula that I think we learned in like eighth grade. It was new minus old divided by old is going to give you the percent change, right? I sure hope that's right. But that's going to be $74 billion minus $71.8 billion divided by old, which is $71.8 billion. That's a percent change from the year. And then you might have to multiply it by like 100 or something to give you like that percentage. But use some of those basic numbers to go over each one of these, read into this, look at their total income, and try to understand it as much as possible. The best way to do this, guys, it's either Google searches or honestly reading some books. Some of my favorite investing books, people ask all the time, The Intelligent Investor, yes, a wonderful book. But you know what? I'll leave a couple of other links down below for some other books as well if you want to read some of those. But I really like the technical ones that just don't beat around the bush about investing and show you the actual information on how to analyze a stock properly. So then we finally have the statement of cash flows. These are all consolidated, of course. You can get the longer form versions of ones if you really want to. But the consolidated statements of cash flows are here as well. Looking at net income. And this should give you a pretty good understanding of where this company stands. So with all this said, yes, it's not a simple process of analyzing a company. And to be honest with you, when I invest into a stock, it's typically not something I do on a whim. It usually takes many weeks, and in some cases, many months, or even in a couple of cases, many years to decide to actually invest into a company, to buy into a stock. Please do not buy a stock on a whim and think that you're going to miss out if you don't buy it by the end of the day today, and you're going to miss out on it. Because if you are investing like I do, or like most investors, you're doing this for the long run. And so if you miss out on a couple of days of profit because the company just announced some very big news, that's okay, because in the long term, you're making sure that you are setting yourself up for success. So there are times when a company stock will go up 20%, and I haven't fully analyzed that company. I haven't read through their balance sheet thoroughly enough to feel confident about the long-term longevity of that company, and so I don't invest into it. Now, there is one more thing that is essential to discuss in this video, and that is when going about buying a stock, it's important for people to not dump too much in at any one particular time, or also to go too heavily into one specific stock. Now, this, of course, is what I do. You don't have to follow my opinions and my suggestions here because, of course, I'm not a financial advisor. I'm just a random guy on the internet. You already knew that. But what I suggest people do is to start to get your feet wet with a company. Don't jump in head over heels, dive head first into a company, putting your entire net worth into a company stock. That's just a recipe for disaster. Imagine in January of 2020, you analyze Carnival Cruise or American Airlines, you say, wow, there's so much potential for this. The industry is supposed to grow dramatically in the future. And you end up buying Carnival Cruise stock in January, right before the whole coronavirus happens, right? You're essentially screwed because you went all in on a company that maybe at the time looked very profitable, looked like a company that was going to do very well, and then suddenly it gets hit hard and you're out like 90% of your investment. So please start to do this over time if you find companies, but also try not to go too heavily into one specific company. I would argue that I really don't put more than 15, maybe 20% of my assets in my individual stocks into any individual stock. So about 18% right now at the moment, 18% of my total assets are in individual stocks. The majority of my assets are in cash, they're in my own business ventures, or they are in index funds and mutual funds, which is a pretty passive way of investing. Then about 18% of that goes into individual stocks. But from that 18% of my assets that are in individual stocks, I try not to invest more than 15 or 20% of that 18% into a specific company. So hopefully you see what I'm saying there. For example, if I'm buying Walmart stock, I'm not going to buy all of my individual stocks, my amount of money that I allot for individual stocks for Walmart. I'm going to split it up among multiple other companies and in different industries to protect myself from situations like what we just had during this recession for 2020. So thanks for watching the video. I hope you found some value in it. If you did, make sure you drop a like and please, please, please let me know what video you want to see next. I will make that video showing people how to analyze a balance sheet and a cash flow statement and an income statement if you really want to see it. But it has to get a lot of views because I'm not going to make it if it's going to get 500 views. I'm just being honest with you. It's not going to be worth my time to do that. Maybe we'll create like a separate channel for it or something. I don't know. So thanks, guys. And I'll see everybody next time.